almost a quarter of a century, ABC Sports has spanned the globe to bring you the Olympics. Again in 1988 at Calgary, the Olympic tradition continues.
They all know the big one is getting close. The most macho of Olympic events is 29 days away, and the pressure is building. Sometimes with disastrous results. They're concentrating on the moves they must make to pass someone like current world champion, Peter Mueller, a 10-year veteran with one last Olympic chance. Deliberate, strong, and the Swiss master of derring do. But there's someone else. Zurbriggen, the name of the king of skiing, a quiet, reluctant hero capable of 4 gold medals at the Olympics. But this year, only 1 win. How ready is he? So today, with thoughts on Calgary, we'll have one of the last tune-ups in men's downhill. Today on ABC's Wide World of Sports, from a little village in the Alps of Austria.
Last week, we showed you young Americans winning the right to represent their country in the Winter Olympics next month in Calgary, Alberta, Canada. Debbie Thomas was one of them. At age 20, the articulate pre-med student regained the U.S. championship. She'll lead a 3-skater American ladies team. Jill Trenery lost her title, but won a place on the team also. As did Karen Kadavy. All 3 of them then, Calgary bound. Brian Boitano of San Francisco will lead the American men's team of 3. Brian retained his U.S. championship last week. Now he heads for Calgary. There, he and Canada's Brian Orser, the 2 Brians going at each other, Brian Orser being the current world champion, they're expected to fight it out for the gold medal. Today on Wide World of Sports, we'll watch the pairs competition as those athletes attempt to join the single skaters as members of the American team. Jill Watson and Peter Oppegaard were the pre-championship favorites, bronze medalists in last year's world championships. The road to Calgary grows shorter today on ABC's Wide World of Sports. Spanning the globe to bring you the constant variety of sport. The thrill of victory. And the agony of defeat. The human drama of athletic competition. This is ABC's Wide World of Sports.
Brought to you by Michelob Light. When the sun goes down, light up the night with Michelob Light. By the Century 21 system, put number 1 to work for you. And by Sears, where there's more for your life.
Thanks again, boys, and keep the change. You hear all this nonsense about Kellogg's Frosted Flakes being just for kids. Well, I, for one, eat them, and I'm going to go right on eating them. Frosted Flakes just for kids, come on. Like we adults have to go sneaking around. Like we can't love these crisp, sweet flakes just as much as kids. Mm. Who is it?
You just have to admit it. Frosted Flakes have the taste adults have grown to love. They're great.
The money that you spent on calls to your mother last month, you could have gone to visit her.
Okay, dear. I'll leave tomorrow.
Northwest can fly you to your mom, your aunt, or distant cousins at fares that can make flying cheaper than talking.
You may not have thought of buying a Sears Die Hard battery until you've had a little time alone to think about it.
Hello again, everyone. I'm Frank Gifford. Just 4 weeks from today, on February the 13th, the Olympic Winter Games begin on ABC Sports. And this afternoon, we'll give you a preview of some of the performers you're likely to see in Calgary. Originally, we were going to bring you skiing today from Kitzbuhel, Austria, the Honeycomb, but the lack of snow there has taken the world's top new men's downhillers to the tiny village of Bad Klein Kirchheim, where they'll be racing on a glacier. Also today, we'll bring you pairs figure skating from the U.S. National Championships in Denver, Colorado. Plus, we'll begin our regular feature, the Wide World of Sports Athlete of the Week Award. Happy you're with us. We begin our show with figure skating. Here's Jim McKay.
The Winter Olympics of Calgary are in the countdown stage now. They'll begin in that Western Canadian city in just 28 days. ABC Sports will cover them exclusively, and today we take one of the final steps on the road to Calgary.
Good afternoon. I'm Jim McKay reporting from McNichols Arena in Denver, Colorado. Once again, we're at the U.S. Figure Skating Championships. Now, last week you saw the men's and the women's competition. This time it'll be the pairs, a very athletic, very beautiful aspect of the sport to watch. Let's take a look at how they stand coming to the final free skating phase. In first place, Jill Watson and Peter Oppegaard. In second place, Gillian Waxman and Tad Wagoner. And in third place, the brother and sister team of Natalie and Wayne Seabolt. Let's bring in at this point former world and Olympic champion Peggy Fleming. Would you run down these first three pairs for us?
Well, Jill Watson and Peter Oppegaard have improved dramatically since last year. They have a new long program, and now when they take the ice, it's with real command with their unison and speed and theatrical style. Gillian Waxman and Tad Wagoner project a rather classical line in their skating. They've been rivals of Jill and Peter's for the past few years. Natalie and Wayne Seabold are not new on the scene. They've been in national competition for the past 6 years. It's either now or never for them.
How about a word then from another world and Olympic champion, Dick Button? What is the state of pair skating in our country today, Dick?
Well, you know, our pair skaters are wonderful, but they're not powerful. We don't have a blockbuster force like the Soviet Union does, for example, where one after the other pairs come, just continue to flow forward from a great system. We've had very good but very few champions, from the Kennedys in 1952 through to the Carruthers in 1984. And when they come, they're wonderful. That's why it's nice to see that we have Oppegaard and Watson, who are medal-ranked skaters, pair skaters. But we don't have great depth, and I'm sorry about it. But the nurturing of pair skaters is very difficult. It's twice as hard as in the singles. It's nice to see it when it happens.
Nonetheless, the U.S. National Championship is on the line here, in addition to which, three teams will be selected to represent the United States in the Calgary Winter Olympics.
The first couple we're going to see is Natalie and Wayne Seabold. They're the athletic heroes of Marion, Indiana. After making the U.S. World Championship team in 1986, they failed to make it last year, but Marion did give up on them. Just when they were most discouraged, the hometown gave them a wonderful boost. Marion's high school basketball team has won the state championship 3 years in a row. But last February, it was the turn of Wayne and Natalie, who's known to everyone in Marion as Kim, by the way, to be cheered on. Town and the high school joined together and held a Skate for 88 benefit with neighbors and friends raising money to pave the way to Calgary. They were honored at their basketball team's last home game.
We went to the gymnasium on a Saturday night, and they had a basketball game during the halftime. 8,000 people gave us a standing ovation, which lasted probably 10 minutes, and presented our family with a check for, I think it was somewhere around $14,000, and it ended up, the total amount ended up being $20,000.
It kind of inspired us to go back and work and work and work, because not only were we, you know, wanting to do this for ourselves and for our family, it's kind of like we want to do it for the whole town now. They'll be just as disappointed as us if we don't make the team, but then if we do make the team, then we have 40,000 people behind us going into the Olympics too. And I think I would rather have those people behind us than those people saying, oh, they got fourth last year, they're not going to make it, rather than now they're saying, okay, you got fourth, let's go, you know, let's make the team. And it's a big inspiration for us.
Great trouble sustaining and supporting the landing. She can't settle into it. If he threw her out further instead of quite so high, it would be easier for her. But of course, that was spectacular.
Then they go and do side-by-side double lutz and double toes. So we know that they can do it. They've done it in practice, but the pressure of competition is so different.
Trying to make a bit of a comeback. They were second in the Nationals in 1985, third in 86, fourth in 87, going right down the line.
Everything is very nice. It's just not crisp enough, pointed enough, and with a great enough point of view. It's just very pleasant, very nice. Here is slow motion now of that move at the beginning of the program. First the leap, now the lutz position. Now watch him throw her up into the air for the triple twist. Good at this point, but look at how high she is and look at how marvelous she is. And she's not quite out on a landing position. The legs were crossed. Her landing leg could just not hold it. And, of course, that's what did her in. This is the move that they have created a certain variation on. First, it's a press slip. Her extension over her head. Now watch this kind of flip turn right there, that twisting turn. And now he'll set her down. He's not allowed to carry, remember, more than a certain number of revolutions. Otherwise, it becomes a carry lift. That's the sable lift.
We got it, buddy.
The next American.
All right.
Now the mark.
5.7.
Pretty solid. 5.6s and 5.7s, 1.55.
And that's exactly right. They were solid. Their skating was solid. It's just that they have yet to get that stage of presence, that command of the ice, and the point of view that is going to make them leap above their competitors and become world and Olympic champions.
And 5.7.
Right. Another set of marks.
All right,
she said. And here they come. She was looking up at the scoreboard in the arena, and here is ours. Got a 5.8 there from judge number two. Otherwise, 5.5s, 5.6s, and 5.7s. Again, solid for composition and style. Let's go down to David Santee.
With those marks, it appears that you have the third slot.
I'm very excited. I'm from the Olympic team, so
it's
our goal.
It's a dream come true. I just thank God for the performance that we had today, because it was like someone just took a whole 100-pound yoke and lifted it off our backs. I mean, after last year, and we fought really hard all year with the help of our coach, Ron Luddington, it's wonderful.
What happened in the throw triple X?
I was a little under-rotated. We gambled and we lost, but, you know, I want to get it in there, so sometimes you take those chances, but it didn't really seem to hurt us too much, so, you know, it's one of those chances you take. I'll land it next time.
Looks like you're going to Calgary. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Well, it'll be a hot time in the town of Marion, Indiana tonight. They love them there.
As automakers, we set some of the world's most rigid standards for the protection of our engines. And only one motor oil
surpasses all U.S. warranty requirements for engine protection
for every weighted cells. And that's Pennzoil. To protect your engine and your warranty, choose Pennzoil.
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 Pennzoil. It's world-class protection.
New Year's, marked by time, remembrance, and that traditional toast with Alka-Seltzer. Fast relief of heartburn with a headache from bidding the year too fond a farewell. Alka-Seltzer, the other holiday tradition.
Today's Duracell lasts 30% longer.
Kathy Durham looks cool under pressure, but just because her blouse is dry doesn't mean she smells good. Because underarm odor is invisible, she needs Sure Roll-On. Sure helps protect against wetness and kills bacteria that cause odor. So Kathy, why go to school with a dry blouse and a false sense of security? Tomorrow, use Sure Roll-On and be just as sure about odor as you are about wetness.
Next Saturday begins with ABC's Professional Bowlers Tour. Then on ABC's Wide World of Sports, over 140 torturous miles swimming, biking, and running all in the same day. Witness one of the most dramatic races ever, the Bud Light Ironman Triathlon World Championship, all next Saturday on ABC Sports.
Now Gillian Waxman and Todd Wagoner in second place as they come to their long free skating program.
This is not a real flashy pair. This is a very classic ballet line. Very nice. Now watch this move. This is a move that they created. She does a death spiral, and he lifts his leg over the top of her. He has to keep that tension in the arm, because it makes that so difficult.
They're looking for a little revenge. They were the champions 2 years ago, lost that title last year to Watson and Opegard, and they're second to them again at this point. Probably in pair skating, it's the throw lift that are the single most difficult and dangerous of all moves. Landing on that eighth of an inch wide blade from that height and that distance is just extraordinarily difficult. Triple jumps and athletic moves has been so strong in both the single skating and the pair skating that sometimes the beauty and the purity of skating has been forgotten. Again, a very nice performance. You know, they're wonderful kids, and they're working very hard, and they're good. But they're not going to rank at Olympic level unless they can get a greater presentation, a greater command, a greater point of view, and a greater clarity of line. Here is the slow motion of their platter lift. Now watch him, first of all, cart her right over and up and out. The position is very nice here. This is dangerous also for his turning. If he catches an edge with his skate, the two of them will come down. There's no way to support it. But that lift was very nice. Now watch him turn her over in the cartwheel aspect of it. Really, that's very nice. Look, good stretch on his leg. And this is a throw triple salto from the back inside edge. Good moves, but she's off long before she got even to the peak of the jump. She was angled, and that's what made it difficult. Here comes the first set of marks. Watchman and Wagoner. Excellent. Look at all those 5.8s, 6.58s, and 3.57s.
It's interesting in the technical merit, all the pairs to date have been plagued with really quite small errors and slips. It's been a very uneven kind of route for most of the pairs today.
Well, what about the second set of marks? Their coach, Pauline Williams. Yeah,
here they are.
They like. Let's
this
have
is
our look at
composition and style.
Oh, a 5.9 there to start off with. 1.59. Everything else 5.7s and 5.8s. Down to David now.
Seemed at the end of the program you had looks of relief on your face. Is that true?
Yeah. Yeah, we felt really good.
It was a pressure situation, and I think we pulled through pretty good.
Yeah, a lot better than last year, huh?
The throw double axel at the beginning of the program, how important was it to the success of the program?
I think extremely important.
That's the catalyst.
Yeah,
really.
Once I land that, I feel real good, so.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Okay, Waxman and Wagoner almost certainly on their way to the Calgary Olympics. Yet to come, the defending champions.
Here's something extra from Selsun Blue. Extra medicated Selsun Blue in the dark blue bottle. What's in it for you?
It's extra medicated for the symptoms of my serious dandruff.
And it tingles as it works.
That's because it has an extra medicine, plus the ingredient recommended most by doctors. You can't buy a more effective dandruff ingredient without a prescription. For serious dandruff, all Selsun Blue formulas, including extra medicated Selsun Blue, have the ingredient recommended most by doctors.
American Express, my daughter and I just had an accident.
Do you need a doctor?
I think she's got a broken wrist.
That was some trip. I'd like to keep this while you're away at school.
Sure.
I guess nothing for you.
It's got my name on it.
Just in case.
Thank you.
Someone who cares when you're far from home. Membership has its privileges.
Dave. New phones come on Monday.
Right.
Computer Thursday. And I think we're ready for that bookkeeper.
Oh, great. Does she load boxes?
Dave, I got us the extra truck.
My partner, Santa Claus.
You can't always prepare for success, but you can count on Ryder to help you handle it with the right truck at the right time.
What about a driver?
David, you're doing a great job.
Ryder. We're there at every turn.
Over 140 miles of pushing the body to the wall. The Bud Light Ironman Triathlon World Championship on ABC Wide World of Sports next Saturday.
Here are the defending champions, Joe Watson and Peter Opegaard. Also, bronze medalists in last year's World Championship for their world class now. Before Calgary, however, first they must defend this title here. And remember that the previous pair, Waxman and Wagoner, had very good marks.
This couple has such fire, and they're very theatrical in their expressive moves they do. And watch this unison. Their opening move is a split triple twist. Watch the height. Very good. Now a throw, double loop. That is just beautiful. It just flows right along. It's an edge jump. Very nice.
One of the interesting things about this pair is that they jump and spin essentially in the opposite direction. And that's very unusual for top pairs and also very difficult.
Throw double axel, and again, watch the height. She has always in the past had
trouble with those landings, but I think with all the training they've done this year, this is that improvement. She has been more consistent, very strong.
That he has a tendency to get her up even higher than she can has the strength to support on a landing. This championship turning out to be a real test.
But watch this next move. It's a forward inside death spiral. Look at the extension. Her crossed legs gives a nice long line. And watch him drag her out. That tension in his arm has got to stay constant to keep her in the right position from falling on the ice. Very inventive.
Watson and Peter Opegard of Detroit, Michigan, trying to successfully defend their title here in Denver.
Here is slow motion on the throw triple salto again from the back inside edge on the left foot. Now watch the height. All of this is perfect. She's wonderfully positioned there and just doesn't seem to be able to hold it. Her back was descending even by the time she got down to the ice. Very, very difficult. The height there was just extraordinary.
The marks
down.
Well, they're the 2.59.
Well, those marks, another one. Those marks are exactly right because the other skaters had high marks too. And to put them into first place, if the judges felt they were first, they had to give them those marks. Remembering they're judging against each other, not against the standard of perfection.
Right.
But against one skater against another.
Coach Rita Lowry.
5.8 and 5.9.
Okay. You can certainly see the difference in height between them right there. Jill weighs just
92 pounds.
And now the scores for composition and style.
Here we go. Composition and style. Again, 5'8 and 5'9. They will retain their championship.
5.9.
Down to you, Dave.
Peter and Jill, your impressions on the march.
Oh, we're pleased with the march.
Very pleased with the march. I had an opportunity to hold back partway through the program, and because we're going so well, I chose not to, and it took a little bit out of us near the end of the program.
After the triple Sacco, things seemed to come unglued a little bit.
That's what I'm speaking of, yeah.
Do you feel that because of that, that the 5.9s for technical merit were deserved?
Well, we went out with double axles, triple twists, throw double axle, we jammed that opening, and to hit the throw triple Sacco would have been a phenomenal thing, and that's what we hope to do at the World Championships. So we wanted to try it here with everything in the program.
Yeah, well, what I felt a little bit tonight, which wore me out, tension, my own personal pressure, and I felt going into the triple set a little tired.
Good luck in Calgary, and congratulations.
Thank you very much.
Okay, sometimes the tension can be summed up simply by saying it's an Olympic year. The tension is just more all the time.
It's a big game, big boy. But you got the stuff, because you got off the ground this morning with a real winner.
Sweetie, sweetie, your whole week. I go tell your mama what the big boys eat.
I can't breathe.
Before and Afrin.
Better.
What Afrin does in 5 minutes takes Sudafed over an hour.
Blocked.
Before and Afrin.
Unblocked.
It's the number one recommended nasal spray.
You know I'm tired of my beat. I try to make some supper, but I can't even eat. Jump in the cow, watch the world from my back. Gotta get you, baby, that's a natural fact. It's the night time. That's the right time. I wanna be with you in the night time.
The night belongs to Michelob. The cold, the ice, the fun of dog sledding. Monday on ABC's World News Tonight.
This Through the Years message is brought to you by Forbes Health System.
When I first discovered I had cancer, my first reaction was, I'm going to die. I was fortunate, though, because that I did detect my cancer early.
Bud Morakna successfully battled cancer and is now leading a full, productive life.
And the best advice I could give you would be to know your body, the warning signs, and see your doctor at least once a year.
Partners Through the Years, Forbes Health System and WTAE-TV. It's a celebration of winter, and you can join the fun at WTAE-TV's Winterfest at Seven Springs. During the week of February 8th, you can participate in dual slalom races, bump skiing contests, and much more. Or just come out and bring the whole family for some winter fun. Pick up your calendar of events with entry form today at all Willie ski shops and all Shop and Save stores. And don't miss out on the excitement. Come out to Seven Springs, February 8th through the 12th for WTAE-TV's Winterfest, brought to you in part by Pepsi. Pitt versus Villanova, tonight at 8 on WTAE-TV.
ABC's Wide World of Sports continues.
And now the results are in on the pairs competition. There they are in the victory stand. The winners, Jill Watson and Peter Opegaard. Second place to Gillian Watson and Todd Wagoner. And third place to the brother and sister team of Natalie and Wayne Sebald. Now, unlike in the dance, all those three American pairs will go to the Olympics. That's the result of the international rules, which are based on the results of last year's World Championships. Let's have a look at the other young Americans who will be representing their country in the Winter Olympics next month. The men will be led by Brian Boitano, headed for an Olympic confrontation with the current world champion, Brian Orser of Canada. Debbie Thomas will lead the American ladies as they attempt to dethrone the defending Olympic champion, Katharina Witt of East Germany. In the opinion of many, it's the strongest American Olympic figure skating team in a long time. For now, this is Jim McKay speaking also for Dick Button, Peggy Fleming, and David Santee. We'll see you in Calgary.
Because of the length of the bowling run over today, we were unable to bring you the dance results. The champions were Susie Simonick and Scott Gregory. Gregory giving an inspiring performance, skating with a herniated disc in his back. He expects to be better for Calgary, and he will be there. Our congratulations also go to the silver medalists, Susie Wynn and Joseph Drouar. Still to come on today's Wide World of Sports, downhill racing from Austria.
and we'll have our athlete of the week. All that coming up on Wide World of Sports. Stay with us.
Take the first step toward a whole new future. During Century 21 Career Opportunity Week and our career sessions, you'll find out why we're number one and how our training and innovative support programs could make you number one. The right place is Century 21. The right time is now. Call your local Century 21 office today. Career Opportunity Week, January 11th through the 17th.
Dan Aykroyd. Patient?
I'm a pathetic human being, sir.
Or doctor?
Hello, Dr. Lawrence Baird's office.
Lunatic or liberator?
Using an electric drill on the human skull is something that, well, we really shouldn't do.
Saint?
I love this man!
Oh, good.
Or Saint Bernard? Dan Aykroyd.
Escaped and at large.
Walter Matthau. The Couch Trip. Rated R. Now playing at a theater you can deal with.
Just when you thought you knew which battery was best for your car, along comes this dynamo. The Megatron 34 from Interstate. The runaway leader in every performance test by a leading consumer products rating service. With cranking power that ran circles around better-known brands and reserve energy that left others stranded. Megatron 34 from Interstate. A bit of a show-off, perhaps. But then, it did test best. Ask for it.
Winter allergies and colds. The sneezing and congestion can make you feel miserable. For relief, discover Benadryl Decongestant. Combining Benadryl with the decongestant found in the leading cold medication, Benadryl Decongestant.
I've got a man with a slow hand. He's got a face that I love to touch.
Schick Super 2 Plus Blades with a comfort strip for the easy touch.
The Olympic spirit surely must rest solely within the individual. And yet it has provided, as the centuries roll along, wonderful dignity for those who just want to try. Not necessarily win, but try.
Still to come, men's downhill racing from Austria. But don't forget, be sure and join us tomorrow on ABC Sports for the final round of golf's Money Tournament of Champions. 1987's tour winners shoot for a piece of the $500,000 in total prize money. And our coverage begins live, except on the West Coast, at 4 o'clock Eastern, 3 o'clock Central and Pacific. Steve Pate is the leader after three rounds. Well, next Saturday on ABC Sports, the Professional Bowlers Tour stops in Grand Prairie, Texas for the $150,000 Quaker State Open. Following bowling, Wide World of Sports presents the Bud Light Ironman Triathlon World Championship. Competitors swimming, biking, and running a total of 140 miles, and they do it all in one day. That's next Saturday on ABC's Wide World of Sports, 4:30 Eastern and Pacific, 3:30 Central Time. Well, the NFL's St. Louis Cardinals will relocate to Phoenix, Arizona, if 21 of 28 NFL owners approve the move at the owners' meeting in March. Cardinals owner Bill Bidwell selected Phoenix over offers from Jacksonville, Memphis, and Baltimore. $17 million a year in incentives and playing in Arizona State's 70,000-seat stadium made Bidwell's decision easy. And yesterday, Cuba announced it would not participate in the Summer Olympics in Seoul, South Korea, unless two conditions are met. One, that North Korea be a co-host of the Summer Games, and that Cuban athletes be guaranteed their safety. The last time the United States competed against Cuba in the Summer Olympics was back in Montreal in 1976. A final note, Jimmy the Greek Snyder was fired from CBS Sports Today for racial slurs he made on a local television show in Washington yesterday. His remarks are not worth repeating here. They were sick, to put it in a very mild way, and you can lay about 1 to 10 that he'll not be back. In fact, this one is off the board. Jimmy the Greek Snyder fired today by CBS. Right now, it's time to begin our regular feature, the Athlete of the Week Award. This week, we honor two women whose beautiful performances were not only the highlight of the sports week, but were also perfectly timed. For America's Debbie Thomas and East Germany's Katharina Witt seem headed on a collision course.
There were others who distinguished themselves this past week. Last Saturday, Anthony Carter of the Minnesota Vikings caught 10 passes for a playoff record 227 yards to lead his team over the 49ers. And last week in Davos, Switzerland, three-time Olympic gold medalist Karen Kania set the all-time record for World Cup points in speed skating.
ABC's Wide World of Sports Athlete of the Week is brought to you by Acura, Legend and Integra. Precision crafted performance exclusively at your Acura dealer.
Debbie Thomas had much to prove at the U.S. Figure Skating Championships last weekend in Denver, Colorado. Last year, she suffered through injuries and lost her world and national titles. But this year, healthy, she recaptured her U.S. title, skating brilliantly to the music from the opera Carmen. Debbie felt her performance was a positive step on the way to the Olympic Games, which begins exclusively on ABC February the 13th.
I hit all of the big stuff. There were a couple of little flaws here and there that can be improved upon for Calgary, but it was really a positive type of a performance, really something good for me to think about going into Calgary.
Thomas's chief rival in Calgary will be current world in 1984 Olympic gold medalist Katharina Witt of East Germany. Witt and Thomas have been foes for some time, and the two are intertwined even more this year. Katharina is also skating her long program to the music from Carmen, an opera set in early 19th century Spain about a beautiful, seductive woman. This week, Witt was in Prague, Czechoslovakia at the European Figure Skating Championships. Wednesday, she skated a remarkable short program, scoring 5-6-0s, a record for international competition. Thursday, she went on to capture her sixth straight European title, another record. Peggy Fleming spoke to Witt last night in Prague about her performance.
I think it was a good first step for me for the Olympics, because it was very important for me to skate good here, because there were so many American and Canadian here to watch and to see me, and it was very important.
How does the fact that both you and Debbie are skating to the same music, the music of Carmen, and how does this affect the rivalry between the two of you?
I think it will be very interesting for the judge and for the audience, and this is, I think this music is a big challenge, and you can just skate to this music or you can try to explain the music. Mm-hmm. And so we will see who is better.
I will be thinking about Katharina in that she is the one to beat, and everybody makes a big deal about Katharina and her being the one to beat. But I mainly need to concentrate on myself.
Katharina Witt and Debbie Thomas, two champions on a collision course set for Calgary. They are ABC's Wide World of Sports co-athletes of the week.
What makes the Formula One world champion such a great race car? Computer program fuel injection, dual overhead cams, four valves per cylinder. What makes this such a great street car? Exactly the same technology. The Integra. Precision crafted performance from Acura.
Tums is one antacid that can really handle heartburn. It's a lot stronger than the number two brand.
That's one good reason we use Tums. And Tums happens to be rich in calcium.
That's the second good reason.
Tums, 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 Tums.
Ace is the place.
20 drawstring kitchen trash bags are only $1.44. This bathroom scale is Best Buy priced at just $4.88. Hey, here's a winning play. Grab the Ace Best Buy and go deep. Hey, let me tell you, Ace is the place for me.
The money that you spent on calls to your mother last month, you could have gone to visit her.
Okay, dear. I'll leave tomorrow.
Northwest can fly you to your mom, your aunt, or distant cousins at fares that can make flying cheaper than talking.
If an MCI customer has a problem, we'll work on it, even into the middle of the night. Maybe someday, we'll work 9 to 5. At least that's what I tell my wife.
Until you call, you'll never know how much better a long-distance company can be.
Pittsburgh's talking about Pittsburgh's talking. The city's newest talk show, airing 10 a.m. weekdays on WTAE-TV, could be the answer for Pittsburghers searching for something more substantial.
Well, it's just about Pittsburgh, and I really like that.
And of host Ann Devlin, she seems to be a person viewers could like a lot, and very soon.
I think she's a very vivacious person. I think she's going to bring out the best in Pittsburgh. I like her.
Pittsburgh's talking, weekdays at 10 on WTAE-TV.
Now we're going to travel around the world to southern Austria and the tiny village of Bad Klein-Kirchheim. A 2.5-hour ride from Kitzbuhel, Austria, the village is renowned for the healing and youthful powers of its thermal baths. Let's join Al Trotwig and Bob Beatty.
We take you 5,900 feet above sea level for the start of today's downhill in Bad Kleinkirchheim, where they didn't have electricity until 1954. And one of the first things they built when they got it was a ski lift. That should tell you something. As we move into the start house now, Leonard Stuck of Austria will be first. And we'll be using pictures provided by Austrian television, which will not provide top-to-bottom coverage, but what they will show will be the best part of this exciting course. To Stock, the winner of only one downhill in his career, and that downhill was the 1980 Olympic downhill at Lake Placid. Now we'll see some very interesting, tight, icy turns at the top here.
Well, you can see also he's trying to stay in a really deep crust, but the problem is with all these little ripples, those skis are flying all over the place.
This is only the fourth downhill of the season. In the first one of the year, the Austrians did not have a top 10 finisher for the first time in World Cup history. But a couple of top 10 finishes by Stock have helped bring the Austrians back.
Well, one of the problems, look at Stock really fly off that bump. You don't want to do that because you catch a lot of air. The problems with the Austrians is the older guys in downhill have stayed on the team and the younger ones haven't had a chance to develop. As a matter of fact, a lot of the good young talent has gone off to slalom.
Now the final few turns on this course. A good time would be about 1:56. We'll see how Stock sets the stage for the rest of the day.
Well, I don't think he's having really all that great a run. He's kind of been all over the place on the top.
In the air frequently down this run, his time, 1:54. Now the other times were set in training. It'll be interesting to see how that time stands.
Full second faster than the best training run yesterday.
And Stock and the Austrians seem pretty happy about it. Now we'll have much more skiing to come and a chance to give you some of the flavor of Bad Kleinkirchheim. Let me tell you, you need planes, trains, and automobiles to get here. It is tucked deep in the valleys of southern Austria. But it is unique because it has snow. A week ago, they didn't even know the world was coming. So here we are where we are not supposed to be. Let me tell you, it did not take long to put this party together, but that's been the story of this World Cup season. Surprises. It began with young Alberto Tomba of Italy winning five races to lead the World Cup. And while he's not a downhiller, we look forward to seeing him in the Olympic Games, now only 28 days away. The season in January, a disaster. Every single event has been moved, shifted, or canceled because Europe is a continent without snow. Today, we were supposed to be celebrating our annual return to the famed Hahnenkamm in Kitzbuhel. But if we took you there today, you'd see only the mountaintops are dusted with the white stuff. The valleys are still green. And if we took you to the finish line of the Hahnenkamm, through that light crust of snow and ice, you'd still be able to see the fairways, bunkers, and greens of the golf course on the finish line. So, Bobby Addy, has been a season of disorganization, and that has added pressure to the preparation for the Olympics.
Boy, I'll tell you, they have to worry about the Olympics, so they're pressing really hard to make their teams and to get ready for them, and all of a sudden, no snow. And when there's no snow, Al, that means you don't get to go out and do some free skiing, and you have to worry, where am I going to be next week? And I think all of that added pressure tightens the races up a lot, and I think it's meant, well, I think it's the reason for a lot of these injuries, frankly.
The American season has been a strange soap opera. They've lost four women to serious injuries. Some hope to be back, and two men are out with serious injuries. And reports now that Harold Schoenaar, the director of the U.S. ski team, might even be fired, Bob, before the Olympics begin.
Well, I talked to Tim Weisel, who is the president of the U.S. ski team, and he lives in San Francisco, just last night, and he said that's not true.
Two names we'll be talking a lot about from Switzerland, Peter Mueller, the world champion, and Perman Zurbriggen, the current king.
Well, as far as Mueller's concerned, he hasn't skied all that well yet, but talking to him yesterday, he had the fastest training run. He said, hey, I'm just the way I want to be. I'm coming along just right, and I'm going to be ready for Calgary. As far as Zurbrugge is concerned, I think he's already there. He won the last downhill in Val d'Isère. He was second in the two downhills that were held in December. And I think Zurbrugge probably feels pretty good about himself right now. There's a lot of pressure on him, though.
Final thought?
Well, I don't know. How do you like between the Cleveland Browns and the Denver Broncos?
Well, I think the Browns have the right wax. That's all I'll say.
The Broncos all the way.
All right. We'd like to welcome Jack Edwards to ABC's Wide World of Sports. He'll tell us what conditions the skiers will face. Jack?
The only white stuff which has fallen around here lately has been man-made snow. Produced by forcing water and compressed air through snow guns, man-made is a lot denser than Mother Nature's version, and it packs down into a surface which closely resembles formica. They say there isn't any snow in Kitzbühel, and that's why they moved the race here. But how much snow is there here? After the packing effect of the training runs, that isn't snow anymore. That's ice.
The Luxembourg ski team is next. His name is Mark Giardelli. 2 years ago, the world's best overall skier. He's had a couple of injury problems since then. In 1977, his father pulled him away from the Austrian skiing program, and now 11 years later, he's finally a Luxembourg citizen.
You know, it's funny about Giardelli, because the Austrians would love to have him on the team, but they, of course, don't have him right now. He's skiing for Luxembourg, but He doesn't start off very well. He was 12th in the first downhill, then he was 6th, and then he was 3rd last week in Val d'Isère. He keeps getting better and better.
He had that knee injury a few years ago, and his father, so prominent in his career, was a little leery of some of the bumps on the upper portion of the course, and you saw Giardelli struggle a little bit there and very high coming into the air that time.
Well, he really flew, but you know, when you fly off a bump like that, sometimes you miss your pre-jump. Sometimes also, it's just you're going so fast.
This should be a slow time. It is more than a second point three slower than Stuck of Austria.
Well, you know, Giardelli dislocated his shoulder at the beginning of the season last year in the first slalom race. I don't think he's going to take a lot of chances. He does not like the bumps very well either.
Really struggling handling the bumps and that turn. Giardelli looking very, very tense. Ski sliding out there, and he'll come across the line with a disappointing 1.55.36.
That's not a run he's going to be very proud of.
But in this city, they are proud of their steaming attractions. But you really do have to learn how to pronounce this city the right way. When you come to this part of Austria, the good word is bad. For those of us that love skiing, there are a few things better than skiing in Austria. But what if you were able to add in something extra, like the bad part of Austria, or really the good part? You see, bad or bad translates into spa. And if you're dressed appropriately enough, or silly enough in this case, you can literally slide right off the slopes into these thermal baths. Excuse me, how is the bad today?
Not bad.
Well, there you have it. See, the spa's not bad, or good, I guess, if you're in Austria. Thank you.
The Porsche 944. The Volvo 740 Turbo Wagon. To you, they're two completely different cars. But to a radar gun, they look exactly alike.
When the sun goes down, gonna light up the night. Silver label, red ribbon, I'll taste that's right. Gonna light up the night. Michelob light. Gonna light up the night.
Ultimate space adventure.
Captain, there's a life force present. It could be dangerous.
On the Disney Sunday movies, Earth Star Voyager.
John Philip Webster, age 32 years. Looks older, acts older. John Philip Webster, 1 year later. Looks younger, feels younger, more confident. The reason? The new Image step-by-step method. Possibly the most advanced hair replacement method ever devised. Definitely the most natural. Call now for your free brochure.
It's coming to every ranch and every farm in every county in America. It's the Census of Agriculture, and we're going out of our way to get information that's vital to America's farm economy. Now, there's two ways we could do this, but this isn't one of them.
Hi, I'm from Washington.
Yeah, I mailed that in this morning, son.
Oh.
That's why we're asking you to mail in your farm census form by February 1st. Let's raise the flag for American agriculture.
Back to Back Horror tonight on Channel 4 WTAE-TV.
ABC's Wide World of Sports continues.
As you look up the valley, you can see that there's not a lot of snow here in Austria, but certainly enough to run this men's downhill. One other thing is obvious, and that is that the Canadian team is very much looking forward to returning home to Calgary. Rob Boyd and his team know they must keep that in perspective.
Well, there's not a real high aura of the Olympics training. We're just trying to concentrate on the races that we're at now, which is what we have to do. Otherwise, you know, if we start thinking about the Olympics now, we're just going to blow it all out of proportion. And got to put extra pressure on us, and it's the last thing we need.
Well, there is additional pressure now. Last year, the Canadians lost Todd Brooker when he crashed at the Hunt and Common Kitzbuhel. Yesterday, in training here, in the replacement for Kitzbuhel, they lost Ryan Stemmel when he fell and twisted his knee. He's returning home. That means additional responsibility now for Rob Boyd.
Well, I'm very impressed by the Canadians, and particularly by this man, Boyd. You know, he won in Valgardena, but that was a very tough course. On a scale of 10, I rank this one about a 7. This might not be tough enough for Boyd, and he hasn't looked very good in training, frankly.
Deep into the tuck, we'll see how he handles going into the air on this upper portion. It is important for the skiers to return to that tuck as quickly as possible.
Those little pine brows we see on the side are for visibility when they hit the shade as they go all the way down the course.
You saw Boyd handle that upper jump very, very well. He's 0.33 off the lead pace.
Sat right on the backs of his skis. He almost went down there. You know, you have to be careful because you can blow a knee out doing that.
Looks like he's being very aggressive, would you say?
Well, he is, but he's got a little bit of time. You know, Stock really had a fast pair of skis. It looked like he was all over the place. I didn't think he was having a good run. But maybe it was just because his skis were running so fast.
Rob Boyd of Canada. Second place, off by 21 hundredths. Another optimistic run for the Canadians. But for now, the time of Leonard Stock stands just as it did at the 1980 Olympics. On that day, a man who prepared his skis used a wax that he had held for 20 years in a box. He felt that it would work that day, and it did. Is Perman Zurbriggen the best skier in the world? Well, two golds and two silvers at the World Championships last year seem to say so. This year, two second places to begin the season. Then finally, a downhill win last week. He seems to be getting ready just at the right time.
Well, he's certainly very happy right now because he skied well in Val d'Isère, riding up the lift with him after the race. I said, Perman, you must be really happy. He said, well, I'm happy for my win, but I just found out that my sister broke her fibula in a women's race. So, very strong family man. He's disappointed by that.
You see how quickly Zurbriggen gets back down into the tuck after he hits the ground, and he has the fastest time on the course.
And he is sailing. Watch how he gets so loose and supple over these little bumps through here.
Cutting it close inside that gate, now winding his way down.
Oh, he got off a little bit there. Almost sat back on his inside ski.
But the athleticism of the veteran gets him right back into the track.
Oh, he was good on that bump. Kept those neat hands right to his boot tops.
He could be the leader. He is by 0.4 of a second. Zurbriggen putting the squeeze on his teammates and the rest of the skiers still to come here in Bad Kleinkirchheim.
He likes it.
And that puts two members of the Swiss team in the top five. The Austrian bell ringers along the course are still happy about Leonard Stock's second place standing. Now, as many of you know, a visit to Europe is a visit to a land made smaller by trains. Yesterday, here in town, a couple of kids got sidetracked by trains made smaller by hand. This proud engineer, Hans Rüttig, in the basement of a drugstore in Bad Kleinkirchheim, proudly surveying his creation of 6,000 hours. This miniature train set that cost him 1 million Austrian shillings, or about $100,000. It's the largest in Austria, open to the public every day, and only 100 yards from the finish line of the downhill. The day we saw Hans, he was a little upset. You see, the 453 locomotive from Munich was 10 minutes late, and with town so busy, there was a half-hour wait at the carousel and Ferris wheel.
Here's why these members of the United States Ski Team prefer Alka-Seltzer Plus cold medicine.
I came down with some mean cold symptoms. I was congested, I was tired, I couldn't breathe through my nose. I took Alka-Seltzer Plus and it helped to remove those cold symptoms.
I've got a number of guys that are depending on me and I have to be out there the next day. And Alka-Seltzer Plus really helps me do that.
Alka-Seltzer Plus cold medicine. Fast, effective relief for tough winter colds. Try new Alka-Seltzer Plus nighttime cold medicine to relieve your cold at night.
You may not have thought of buying a Sears Die Hard battery. until you've had a little time alone to think about it.
This man once had a heart attack. Since then, his doctor prescribed exercise, the right foods, and aspirin. Studies show aspirin can help prevent second heart attacks. Ask your doctor about aspirin. Bayer, the wonder drug that works wonders.
There's a town where the assembly line mentality does not exist. Where craftsmanship is revered. Where precision is a way of life. A town where the largest occupation is that of car maker. The town is Kalmar, Sweden. The only place in the world where this car could be built. The new Volvo 760.
Next Saturday, ABC's Wide World of Sports presents the endurance event that started it all. Over 140 torturous miles of swimming, biking, and running. Witness one of the most dramatic finishes ever in the Bud Light Ironman Triathlon World Championship. On January 30th, the action comes from Rotterdam, Holland. Only the finest in the World Gymnastics Championships. Plus, a day before the big game, a special live Super Bowl preview. And on February 6th, the rematch the boxing world's been waiting for. The Tasmanian Devil, IBF lightweight champion Vinny Paziente, defends his title against the man he took it from, former champ Greg Haugen. The top events keep coming your way on ABC's Wide World of Sports.
Last year at this time in Austria, the Canadian suffered the loss of Todd Brooker. He had to retire following a crash. And if you saw that crash, you know how lucky he is to be standing talking to Rob Boyd. Now, yesterday in training, again in Austria, the Canadians may have lost Brian Stemmel.
And Stemmel has really been hot in training. He's just discovering that he could win, and he's going for it. But when he came off that bump, he sat back and tried to save himself. It was felt that he might have injured his knee right then when he was trying to hold himself into his stock. He's on his way back to Toronto. Arthroscopic surgery to be performed tomorrow.
To the current world champion, Peter Mueller, who sits way back when he skis. Yesterday, Bob asked him about that special position.
I have a special position that I know, but it's the best position for me, and I'm not the slowest, you know, and so I take this position, that's right.
What about when you go off the bumps? Do you have to change your position a little bit?
You must look that you'll be in front with the most of the weight when it comes to jump, and that you can good push, and that the ski tips go down and not up, and then it's no problem.
Last year at the World Championships, Peter Mueller emerged, despite his critics, to claim the gold medal. And with a ninth place finish this year, people thought he may have been on the decline again. He's not getting any younger, but now suddenly here in Austria, he's skiing very well.
Well, he's 30 years old and he has win on his mind. And we can see that position that he talks about, where he kind of has that butt right on the tail of his skis right there. It's very unusual because you think he'd catch a lot of wind in his chest, but I think maybe having that weight back there gives him a little bit more speed. He certainly likes it.
So down low into the tuck, his rear end almost scrapes the ice. Mueller showing all the experience on a run he loves because it forces him to work the entire way down.
And you know, he is so strong, he can hold that position. A lot of racers couldn't hold it, but he is the strongest racer, also with the fastest time.
He has taken the lead from Zurbriggen, and with that intermediate time, we'll see if he can hold it.
Oh, he's having a good run. He's starting to feel confident. He is flying down through here.
We've marveled at his grit before, once winning with a broken wrist and with a tenuous back at the World Championships in Crom, Montana. And now with the Olympics of Calgary fast approaching, Peter Mueller is ready. He is the leader with a run faster by 27 hundredths of a second over Zurbriggen. He is thrilled.
And so are the Swiss. They're 1 and 2 right now.
And off in the crowd, Hermann Zurbriggen will get the news, and he can't believe that Mueller has gone on by to take the lead here at Bad Klein-Kirchheim. The Swiss, 1 and 2. Rob Boyd of Canada to fourth. To the top of the mountain we go, to Jack Edwards.
If that hand was coming out of a wicker basket, it would look like a charmed cobra. Downhillers put not snakes, but themselves into trance-like states here in the start area. No, it isn't some new level of consciousness, but it is a concentration tool which many downhillers use. The hand is the skier. The movements mimic reactions to terrain. Sports psychologists only recently have begun to encourage athletes to participate in what they call positive imagery, the practice of seeing yourself doing something well before you perform. Now, when the racer gets in the gate, all that rehearsal is done, and the confidence is reinforced. If the legs ski the course as well as the hand just raced it, well then, that little snake exercise has worked, like a charm.
West Germany's best downhill skier, Markus Vossmeyer, may have thought he led a charmed life after coming back from a contusion of the spine that he received in a crash last year in Furano, Japan. He has the ability in this and in other skiing disciplines to give Germany its first gold medal in the Olympics since 1936.
Well, he does, but he only weighs 154 pounds, and that's not much for a flat downhill, a relatively flat downhill like this. Where Vossmeyer is good is when it's really steep and icy. As a matter of fact, the one in Calgary on the top should be absolutely perfect for him.
Why would a lighter skier not have the same success as a heavier one?
Because he just doesn't have the weight to push those skis down and really make them run like a Zurbriggen or a Michael Mayer from Italy, who's yet to come.
Vossmeyer's intermediate time in comparison to that set by Mueller, 0.75 slower.
Vossmeyer went to New Zealand, paid his own way there, 30,000 Deutschmarks, which is about $18,000, just to train last year and get himself in shape and get over that back injury.
He says he's really gotten to the point where he enjoys the time away from skiing. When he's on the mountain, he seems to enjoy it all the more.
Well, he's had a good result right there. He's in fifth place so far. Not bad for a 154-pounder.
Well, the question now is, Bob, is there anybody left who could possibly catch the leading time of Peter Mueller? And right now, Mueller is sharing time with the hot Italian, Alberto Tomba. They're helping make this little village famous for skiing, but it is also well known for churches. And there's a reason for that. Bad Kleinkirchen. Translated, it means the spa at the home of the small church, of which there are many in this southern Austrian valley. Like St. Ulrich, built in 1710, with a ceiling that details Emperor Ulrich's fight with the Turks. We're told that he won. Before that, in the early 1500s, Baroque and Gothic designers built the majestic steeple of St. Oswald. But even this Jesuit house of worship was not the first in this village that holds religion and hot springs so dear. It was on top of a hot spring in 1493, St. Catherine was built, named for the patron of health. This is the small church which gave the name to Kleinkirchen.
Still up with his cold, sniffling through tissue after tissue, losing count of his coughs and sneezes. Why is he wrestling with aches and pains, suffering instead of resting? Why? Because he's been waiting for something new. New cherry flavor NyQuil. The great tasting, nighttime sniffling, sneezing, coughing, aching, stuffy head fever so you can rest medicine. In original or new cherry flavor.
Of the world's leading motor oils, only one exceeds all car makers' U.S. warranty requirements and surpasses the American Petroleum Institute's highest standards for car engine protection for every weight it sells. Only one oil, only Pennzoil. You can't buy better engine protection for your car. So choose the world-class protection of Pennzoil motor oil.
Last year, they all tasted victory. Tom Watson, Curtis Strange, Larry Nelson, and Scott Simpson. Now they are among an all-champion field vying to become this year's first winner on the PGA Tour. It's the final round of the Money Tournament of Champions, tomorrow on ABC Sports.
Here is skier slash farmer Sepp Wildgruber of West Germany. He has 40 cattle on that farm that wreak havoc with his training schedule. But Bill Gruber won't be thinking about those cattle, not now, not when he's on the course. When he's out there, he skis for fun, and he's been able to balance that free time with his time on the mountain very, very well.
Well, this 29-year-old is kind of amazing in a way. He's kind of winding down his career. He's never been all that exceptional when he usually cracks the top 10, and that's why he's in the top group of 15 in the rankings. But you know, I think it's going to be not that long before old Sepp is going to be retiring to that farm. Oh, you got back a little bit. You don't want to let those tips come up in your face because, first of all, it's dangerous for your health. You can sit back on your skis and fall. But also, you lose a lot of time because that wind pushes you back.
What does that feel like when the wind hits the front of the skis as you come into the air?
Well, I think it's the old story, Al. As we mentioned one time last year, stick your head out the window going about 70 miles an hour and you'll know exactly how it feels.
That's where
that... Oh! Boy, it doesn't take long.
That is why the skiers wear the face protection and the eye goggles.
Okay, Al, we can see him coming up here now. He comes off the jump actually in pretty good shape. But when he lands, well, it's a little slick right there. He kind of lost that left ski. And boy, I'll tell you, splitting right between your skis is probably the toughest type of fall you can take. He really did take a bad one, didn't he?
It's nearly impossible not to wince when you watch it.
Boy, don't like to see a guy roll over and over like that.
Medical personnel now quickly being hoisted to the scene by helicopter where Sepp, and now he's sitting up. That's a very good sign. Sepp Wildgruber of West Germany is moving. He wasn't moments ago. It looks as though he might just have a bloody nose. I'm sure they'll take a closer look at him soon. Mueller and Zurbriggen once again creating a Swiss skiing story here in Austria.
Kentucky Fried Chicken, we do it right. We do chicken right.
The Porsche 944, the Volvo 740 Turbo Wagon. To you, they're two completely different cars. But to a radar gun, they look exactly alike.
6 years ago, Frank Picard of France won the Junior World Championship. It was during those formative years he idolized skiers like Giardelli and Zurbriggen, who skied all the events, and that's why he does it now. Now we'll get a chance to see what he's like in downhill.
Well, this 23-year-old is a good downhiller. As a matter of fact, in Val d'Isère, France last week, in a Super G, he finished second, but that Super G was almost like a downhill, and I am impressed with his skiing. Oh, he was good on that bump. Kept his back level and landed with those skis flat. Very good.
And now the intermediate time, 47 hundredths of a second. He is really having a good run.
Well, he's very nice and loose and relaxed on his skis. Oh, good and tight on that turn. Excellent right there. Got back a little bit. Raise up. That'll cost him a little bit.
129. Final few turns now for Frank Picard of France. He is going to challenge the leaders. Look out.
He is flying down through here.
Picard's time, third place, 34 hundredths of a second off the lead of Mueller and very close to Zurbriggen. You're not supposed to do that when you ski from 39th position.
And the French have something to cheer about.
And so does Frank Picard. This will, however, be a day for Peter Mueller and Hermann Zurbriggen. Mueller erasing thoughts of early season disappointments now, saying clearly that he and Hermann Zurbriggen are ready for those Olympics And that certainly will set the stage for what I think will be a dramatic downhill in Calgary. Let's go to Jack Edwards and see what Peter has to say.
Peter, you are perhaps the strongest skier on the World Cup. Was your strength the difference today?
I think it was very important today. It was so icy, so many bumps, and then it's very important that you have that you are enough strong, yeah.
What was the most important thing, keeping the good position before you got into the air?
I think you must have a very good position, and you must look that you can push the bumps, and that you are not too much in the air, and then it's possible. And on the ice, you must look that you don't slip down, that you can go on the ideal line.
Well, you're on your way to the Olympics with your first win of the year. Congratulations.
Thanks a lot.
Peter Mueller, the winner today.
The American downhillers without injured Doug Lewis could do no better than the 51st place finish of A.J. Kitt as some of the younger skiers get experience. But that's not the story, Bob, with Bill Johnson, the 84 gold medalist.
Well, it certainly is now. People keep saying, what's wrong with Bill Johnson? Well, these pictures tell the story right here. He's nowhere near the way he was in 1984. Look at him. He's sliding through his turns. He really isn't fighting very hard. He's just fighting for his life to stay in there. There he was, almost off the course completely.
4 years ago, the smiles were Bill Johnson's. Today, they're Peter Mueller's.
Unfortunately, our men skiers are not the only ones who have suffered this season. Already, two of our top women, Tori Pillinger and Eva Twardokens, have been injured, and they will not be able to compete in Calgary. In addition, three others have suffered injuries that have forced them to miss large chunks of training time. However, Hillary Lynn has come back, this young skier from Alaska, and on Thursday in a World Cup event, she finished 10th, while Pam Fletcher from Massachusetts had a 9th-place finish. So the news is getting just a little brighter for the women. Tamara McKinney, our best hope for a medal on the women's side, is making great strides in her recuperation from a broken bone in her left leg, and she will be ready for Calgary.
And the exercises we've been...
U.S. women's team veteran and 1983 World Cup overall champion Tamara McKinney has been recovering from a fractured fibula. The break just above her left ankle occurred during training runs in early November. With the guidance of Dr. Richard Stedman, whose rehabilitation of injured skiers at times seems miraculous, and a specially designed brace, Tamara has kept up a rigorous conditioning program. It was just over a week ago that she was allowed to get back on her skis.
Right now I'm kind of working on a plan for my next few weeks. The Olympics are starting up in, I think, about a month. And so I'm training now, just starting back, training in the gates and pre-skiing as much as I can here in Squaw Valley. And, you know, I'm just kind of doing what I can. The last few days I've just been working on pre-skiing long runs, trying to get my legs tired and then get my feeling back for the snow. And starting this next week, I'll be training in GS gates and just building up. I have to kind of start over a little bit, but just building up on giant slalom, and then hopefully next week I can start running some slalom.
Tamara McKinney, and we certainly hope she will be back. Fine little girl we first met in 1980 up at Lake Placid. Okay, right now we're going to join live Al Trattwig and Bob Beatty reporting today, same day coverage of the downhill in Austria. And of course, they're where you usually find them, having a good time at one of the local pubs. And Al, this will be the last time we'll see the men's competition in skiing, all of alpine skiing. What thoughts did you take away before Calgary? One of them has to be that the Swiss are really ready.
Well, frankly, the skiers will have a few more events before the Olympics, but this will be the first chance we get a chance to see them perform. Now, the Swiss had 5 in the top 20, and as you know, the top 2 positions, it's going to be a great duel between Mueller and Zurbriggen. But the Austrians, who have been here at the base of the mountain since the event ended socializing, are happy that their 1980 champion Leonard Stock had such a great race today. West German Sepp Wildgruber, we remember he crashed. He is in a hospital in nearby Klagenfurt today with what they say is a strong concussion. He'll remain in the hospital overnight. And finally, the French, with their best downhill results since 1972 with Frank Picard, are very optimistic. Now, you mentioned Bob Beatty. He's over here, of course, socializing himself. Oops, excuse me. And enjoying some of this fine Austrian food. Now, we've been talking an awful lot about the American situation and what's been going on there.
Well, the American situation is not so great right now. They haven't been doing well. There's been a lot of injuries. We know that. The other problem is that there are no older, experienced racers within the team to provide the leadership that they need, Frank. And, you know, without leadership, these young kids are really fighting for their lives. They're learning, but they've got a long way to go. And then I think the other thing is, well, the development program has not been very good since 1984. I'm very pleased to say right now that there's a really good, solid development program in place as of the last 6 months. Coaches have been hired in the regions, and it's going to be great here in a few years, but we're going to have to be patient. It's not going to happen overnight.
Okay, Bob. Well, that's the story as we approach the hour of midnight. Frank and Bob Klein, Kirchheim, we send it back to you in New York.
Thank you, Bob. Thank you. I'll stay out of trouble over there. I've traveled that region with Bob before, and you can get in a little bit of trouble over there. Okay, that is Al Trotwig and Bob Beatty reporting from Austria. The situation not too good on the men's side. We never know, however, as we move up to the Olympics. The women, however, are improving in the world of alpine skiing. And, of course, all of our coverage today is sort of leading up to the Olympic coverage. That, of course, will kick off really for us on February the 7th when we bring you a special on the Olympics, and we will all be reporting from Calgary on that. There you are, the Calgary 88, the Olympic adventure would begin Sunday, February the 7th. And, of course, the Winter Olympics begin the opening ceremony, and that night, the U.S. hockey team will meet Austria. All of that coming up on our Olympic coverage. Bud Light, Ironman Triathlon coming up next week on Wide World of Sports. Thank you for being with us. Have a pleasant evening.
Spanning the globe to bring you the constant variety of sport. The thrill of victory. And the agony of defeat. The human drama of athletic competition. This has been ABC's Wide World of Sports.
Brought to you by Volvo, a car company you can believe in. By Alka-Seltzer. For stomach upset with a headache, send the bubbles of Alka-Seltzer to the rescue. And by the American Express card. Membership has its privileges.
This has been a presentation of ABC Sports, recognized around the world as the leader in sports television.